Benny Goodman was one of the most significant musicians of the swing era, sometimes called the big band era. Goodman was a virtuoso clarinetist, and he led one of the most popular bands in the country. Possibly even more significant than his musical contributions was his willingness and determination to integrate black and white musicians, and in the process, audiences. Benny Goodman was born in 1909, the ninth of 12 children. His Jewish parents had immigrated to Chicago from Poland and Lithuania, both countries controlled by Russia. Despite the fact that the family was very poor, his father arranged for music lessons for his kids through the local synagogue. Benny studied with a clarinetist from the Chicago Symphony, which gave him a strong classical foundation, even as he was listening to the clarinetists in the New Orleans jazz bands. He began working as a professional musician when he was 14, and he played in a band with Bix Beiderbecke. In 1926 or 1927, Benny moved to New York, and he worked alongside other musicians who would become prominent during the swing era, including Glenn Miller and Tommy Dorsey. In the early 1930s, Benny's first recording sessions as a leader were arranged by John Hammond. Those sessions were also the debut recordings for Billie Holiday. Benny's big break came in 1935 when he was offered a weekly appearance on a radio show called Let's Dance. He needed a lot of new material quickly, and John Hammond suggested using Fletcher Henderson's book, since Fletcher's band had broken up because of the Depression. Benny hired Fletcher's musicians to teach his band how to play the music, and Fletcher continued to write new charts for Goodman's band. This cut, King Porter's Stomp, was composed by Jelly Roll Morton, arranged by Fletcher Henderson, and performed by Benny Goodman. Benny's spot on Let's Dance was the last of a three-hour radio program, airing at 12:30 a.m. on the East Coast. As such, it didn't attract a large audience, although Benny did record some hits during the 6 months that he was on the show. When the show was canceled, he took the band on a cross-country tour. At the time, a big band's book of charts would be comprised of sweet and hot numbers. The hot charts would be epitomized by Fletcher's arrangements, and they would have been the musician's preference to play. The audience reaction to the hot charts during the tour was disappointing, and by the time the band had reached the West Coast, they were demoralized and dispirited. At a gig at the Palomar Ballroom in L.A., after playing a set of sweet music to a largely disinterested audience, drummer Gene Krupa said to Benny, "If we're gonna die, let's die playing our own music." When they came back out to play some hot charts, the audience went crazy. Unbeknownst to Benny, he had developed a fan base on the West Coast who had been listening to his radio broadcasts at 9:30 p.m. their time. That 1935 gig at the Palomar can be seen as the point at which the swing era took hold. Later the same year, Benny formed a trio with Teddy Wilson on piano and Gene Krupa on drums. Wilson didn't play with the big band, but the trio would play on breaks at the big band concerts. Now, they wouldn't have gotten away with that in the segregated South, but Goodman could afford to turn down those gigs. About a year later, Lionel Hampton joined the trio, making it a 50-50 black and white quartet. This is a clip of the quartet from a 1937 movie called Hollywood Hotel. The big band appears as well. In 1937, Benny Goodman's publicist suggested presenting a concert in Carnegie Hall. Now, that was a radical idea. Jazz had never been performed there, and Benny was skeptical that his fans would be content to sit and listen rather than dance. Eventually convinced, the concert took place on January 16, 1938. It was an ambitious program, which included a jam session featuring musicians from Count Basie and Duke Ellington's orchestras. Earlier that night, Basie's band had been at the Savoy, battling it out with Chick Webb. That was also an historic event, coincidentally occurring on the same night. The Goodman concert was a smashing success, selling out weeks in advance. People lined up for blocks to get in. This has gone down as one of the most famous concerts in jazz history, both for the fact that it was one of the first large-scale integrated performances and because doing it in Carnegie Hall conferred mainstream respectability on the music that was heading for mass appeal. This edited clip is comprised of still shots and newsreel footage of the Carnegie Hall concert. We hear a trumpet solo from Harry James, who became a star of the swing era in his own right. He married movie star Betty Grable a few years later. Drummer Gene Krupa, who we hear driving the band to a climax, was an important figure in the evolution of jazz drumming and of the drum kit itself.
Thank you.
Benny was crowned the King of Swing, although evidently that term had already been used to describe Gene Krupa by the Slingerland Drum Company. In 1939, Mary Lou Williams told John Hammond about an electric guitarist named Charlie Christian. This is another example of Mary Lou Williams being on the cutting edge, as the electric guitar was a very new idea. Hammond suggested that Benny hire him. Benny didn't like the idea of the electric guitar, nor evidently Christian's taste in clothes. On the sly, Hammond put Christian on stage during a break during one of Benny's performances, which seems like a very audacious move. Benny responded in anger by calling a tune that he thought Christian wouldn't know, Rose Room, but Christian both knew it and killed it. After that, Benny hired him for his new sextet, which also included Fletcher Henderson. Charlie Christian was an important figure in the development of bebop, and we'll talk more about him when we get there. But the fact that Benny hired him is a significant part of his legacy, both musically and racially. As swing evolved to bebop, Benny was intrigued by the new approach. He had good things to say about Thelonious Monk in the 1940s. Later on, though, he seemed to reject bebop and ultimately stuck with his swing style. Benny had the chops and the interest to tackle classical repertoire as well. In the same year as the Carnegie Hall concert, he recorded the Mozart Clarinet Quartet, and then he recorded that again in the 1950s with the Boston Symphony Orchestra. He commissioned and premiered works by major composers. Here's a clip from a 1940 recording of a piece by Béla Bartók called Contrasts. Benny commissioned it in 1938, and Bartók is playing the piano part. Benny set high standards for himself and for his musicians. He was a notoriously tough bandleader who would fix people with a stare that was known as the Ray. There was a benevolent side, too, as he would anonymously fund college educations for deserving people. Benny Goodman was one of, if not the most famous bandleaders during the swing era. The breadth of his musical endeavors and his role in advancing the cause of integration earned him a special place in jazz history. Here's a live clip from 1955. Benny seems relaxed and happy. Teddy Wilson demonstrates his polished technique playing without a bass player, and Gene Krupa exudes the energy and joy in the music that he always seemed to.